বয়সকে ডুবে যেতে বল, নাহলে কোহোস্ট কি করে করবো?
So yeah, good evening everyone. This is Priya. So I'll be presenting today the behavior of the butterflies, which I've done my master's on. And I've been working with Nature Mates for the past 9 months, and without them, this study wouldn't be possible. So let's just quickly move on to what I've done and show you behavior and some interesting facts. So, firstly, what is this roosting behavior actually is? So, it is nothing but the state of reduced activity marks the end of the day in butterflies as well as the other species. So, ask that how is it different from sleeping? Because they sound similar. So saying that, sleeping is something. A state of resting, which is completely unconscious, or a particular human being or a particular organism is completely unconscious when they are sleeping. But while roosting, when they are roosting, butterflies or any other species, they are not completely unconscious. Some consciousness is there. Thus, even a slightest sound or a slightest disturbance can make them change their positions. So, roosting is a behavior. Is shown the longest period of time in case of butterflies, because in 24 hours of the day, around 12 to 15 hours they spend on roosting, and the rest of the day they spend on other activities like nectaring, basking, egg laying, etc. So from this we can say that roosting is an integral part of a butterfly's day or a butterfly's behavior. It can be classified into two types. One is solitary and another is communal. So here,
Prash, sorry to interrupt. Your voice is breaking, actually.
Hello.
Yeah, your voice is breaking. Can you please check the internet connection?
So is it all right now?
Still breaking a lot.
So is my sound clear now?
Yes. Yeah. Please continue.
Okay. So let's just start. So let's just start from the beginning, or should I start from where I left?
Yeah, you can start from the beginning.
So, what I was saying, that roosting is a state of reduced activity which marks the end of the day in butterflies as well as other species. So, there might be a question that how it is different from sleeping. What I explained, that in sleeping, while a is not completely unconscious and still some consciousness is there, and if they have some disturbance or slight sound, they can change their posture. They spend 12 to 15 hours of their day on roosting out of the 24 hours. Rest they spend on nectaring, basking, and other activities. So roosting can be classified into two types. One is solitary and other is communal. Here in the top right corner, you can see a bush-bound butterfly is roosting alone. So solitary roosting is nothing but when a particular individual occupies a particular perch or a particular substrate while roosting. And the other one is at the bottom right corner, the communal roosting, where not only one but many individuals roost together on a particular site or branch or a particular part of a tree. So why this, what is the reason behind these kind of behavior or showing this kind of behaviors? There can be many factors or reasons. One is the circadian rhythm of the butterflies, because every butterfly has their own circadian rhythm and their own biological clock what they follow. Every butterfly wakes up at a different time and they perform their task on their own time. And sometimes they can match together with another butterfly or sometimes they don't, but it depends on a circadian rhythm or the biological clock of the butterfly, or it can depend on the seasonal variation as well. In my study, I've seen that many species roost of communal roosting in, they roost communally in the winter season, and some of them do not in the winter but only in summer, and some of them throughout the year. So it the seasonal variation might be an explanation. So yeah, now why we have to observe this behavior, roosting behavior. In this picture, you can see that here is a mating pair of a blue tiger butterfly. Butterflies are the only species which roosts while mating as well. So this is a very interesting fact that we have to follow and we have to catch up on, that how this behavior occurs or how they manage to do this. So this is a very interesting fact, and that's why we can observe this behavior more, to learn more. And the other thing is all the butterflies or individual butterflies has different patterns of roosting. Like I said, they have different biological clocks, so they have different roosting patterns. For that, we can follow this as well. And for communal roosting, if we observe closely or if we observe minutely, that every individual fights for that particular spot or a little spot where they are safe, and why they are doing that or how they are managing to rest in the same place with others is still a mystery. And why they do this could be the probable reasons, possible reasons. What could be the possible reasons? That can be searched by observing this behavior. And the most important thing is, if you have butterflies or you observe butterflies in your surroundings, that means you are part of a healthy ecosystem. The environment you are living in is healthy because they are the bioindicators of our environment. So these are the very few reasons why you can observe this behavior and you should do this. Then my study area, this is the Ecotourism Park Butterfly Garden situated in North 24 Paragana's district of West Bengal. Why I have chose this as my study site, because as it is a butterfly garden, it has huge amount of butterflies. So that's how I'll get more roosting data as well. But why they are so abundant here? Because the habitat that they like or they prefer is right here. More than 150 species of trees, herbs, shrubs, and grasses can be found in the habitat of just 3 acres. So this is why I have chosen this Ecotourism Park Butterfly Garden as my study site. So these are some of my habitat area pictures. I use small grass to tall trees, you can see everything. So this is why I have chosen this place to study the roosting behavior. And it is not like a forest floor or a forest patch where you cannot access the interior parts of the forest and thus you cannot watch this behavior, because butterflies are very small creatures and you cannot see them for the naked eye. And in the forest, it is so how a common people or someone who doesn't know about the science and research can observe this roosting behavior. So first, what you have to do is locate a nearby place where you have all the plants and trees and vegetation where there might be a possibility of finding a butterfly or two. Then you have to venture out at dusk. That is because butterflies roost only after dark, so you have to go out at dusk to find them out. Then you have to observe closely to see any butterfly if there is present or not. And if they are present there, you have to identify, and if possible, you can count them as well, because then you can say that if it is a communal roosting or a solitary roosting or whatever it is. So yeah. So there's no rocket science in observing the butterflies. There's very few things you need. First one is a torchlight for finding them after dark, a camera for documenting them, and the most important thing you need is a guidebook of local butterflies to identify the butterfly after spotting. Because at first, when you observe the butterflies or see the butterflies, you will need something to refer to get to know the names and how they look or identify the butterfly species. So a guidebook is very important. And if that interests you further and you want to know about the larval forms and other forms, their host plants and how they behave, then you can visit iFoundButterflies.org. It's a India-wide website where you can find from Himalayas to Western Ghats, every butterfly species found, mostly recorded, and you will get more information and details about them. So yeah. And now what I have observed in my study area, So butterflies are mostly of five families found here. Overall, there are six families which are found in West Bengal, and five families are found here, and I've encountered all five of them. So these are the largest species. These are the papilionids. They are the largest among all the butterfly species. So it is all the individuals of this species roost at the last. So even after dark, you can see one or two papilionids roaming here and there. And a very interesting fact that the above two pictures, one is lime swallowtail and another is tail jay. So these are the two butterflies. They roost with wings closed. At the bottom, common mormon and common rose, these two butterflies, they roost with wings open. So in the same family, papilionidae, how the individuals of the species differ in the patterns of roosting. So this is a very interesting fact upon which we can follow upon. So why they do that? This is a very interesting thing. Now coming to the pereids, these are the some pereids which I have encountered in my study. This is the psyche, the common grass yellow, eastern striped albatross, lemon emigrant, and Indian wanderer. So these butterflies, they are smaller than the papilionids, but they also remain active at dusk. Papilionids, like, they settle after dark around 6:30 in the summertime, and after 6 or almost at 6 in the winter. But papilionids, although they are active at dusk, but settles just before papilionids around in summer, they settles around 6 o'clock or 5:45, and in winter season they roost earlier than that. And now coming to the third family, which is the nymphalid family. There are some nymphalid species I've encountered. There are the plain tiger, striped tigers, common foraging, commander, common leopard, common evening brown, and common crow. So These are the nymphalid species. They are not as large as papilionids. They are medium-sized butterflies. And they also roost pretty much after dusk, after sunset. When the light is still there, they are always roaming. But in winter season, they roost quite early, around 5 o'clock. If you venture out at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, then you will see nymphalids roosting. So, but, and nymphalids also, here you can see, like papilionids, nymphalids also roost with closed wings and as well as open wing. Here you can see a commander butterfly which is roosting with open wing, and all the other species are roosting with the wings closed. So you can see here there's also a thing in nymphalids as well with open wings and closed wings. And why it is that? It needs to be researched. And I've mentioned about periods that here, if you observe them, all of them are roosting with wings closed. So we can assume or we can deduct that they prefer to roost with their closed wings and rather than open wings. So now coming to the fourth family, the Lycaenids, they are the smallest of all the butterflies. They are called the small blue butterflies. So when I was doing my study, it was a winter season, and in winter, Lycaenids are the most abundant species. And like here you can see the most species have shown till now. There are ape flies, pale grass blue, common line blue, lesser grass blue, plains blue, and all species of flies. Here you can say, or you might, the question might arrive that in these pictures there are still light in these pictures. So how they are roosting, or how you are saying that they are roosting? They are roosting because as they are the smallest butterfly, their body size is very small. So they don't have that much energy to spend on and to grow till sunset or after dark to roost. They have to settle early to gain that energy back. And that's how you can see that the lights here in the pictures, because even when I was photographing them, it was already the sunlight or the some light was already there. So you can see some light here. So this is also a reason that Lycaenids roost way early, around 4 o'clock on winter season and 4:30 to 4:45 in summertime. By that time, they already start roosting. And here also, you can see that all the Lycaenid species, they are also closed wings. So they cannot roost with wings open. Now coming to the fifth and final family, which is the Hesperids. Here also, you can see some light in the pictures. Here, these are the same things, that they are also very small in size. They are slightly larger than the Lycaenids, but still very small in size. So they also roost around 5 o'clock in winters and 5:15 to 5:30 in summertime. So here you can see that these butterflies also, they are also showing roosting with closed wings. But the butterfly, one butterfly species is there, which is banded awls. Like the all species, brown all and common banded all. These two all species, they are the one exceptions that even if it is dusk and after dusk, they roam around nectaring and doing all the other activities. But other Hesperids, they don't do that. So it is an exception for those Hesperids which are found. I haven't seen them roosting, probably for that reason that they roost way after the other Hesperids. So yeah. Now coming to all these talks about roosting and how you observe, what you should observe. Because, so what we can observe is where do the butterflies roost? So like all the other animals, butterflies also need a place in which they are safe and are outside of predators' eyesight. That's why they have to choose a place where they can camouflage as well, and which is also nearer or closer to their resources. So like the smaller butterflies license, they cannot go a long way to collect food even just after getting up. So they have to keep that in mind as well. So there are various reasons or factors which is there when a butterflies choose a place to roost. So not only plants, these creatures can utilize any place they find suitable and what fulfills their requirement. I will be showing you some examples. Here you can see a common crow mating pair on a leaf. And here is a Lycaena species called dark cerulean, which is roosting on a flower. So this might be a reason that as they are Lycaenids, so after getting up or waking up in the morning, they cannot go too far to collect food resources. So they are roosting flower that even after getting up, just after getting up, they can collect food resources from here and then they can start their day. And this is a which is roosting on a fruit. And this is a Lycaena, again another Lycaena which is roosting on a dead flower or dried flower. And this is a commander butterfly, which I was saying that they can roost at any place. I've seen this butterfly to roost at a golf fence, at a fence, which is dividing my study area and another part. So it is roosting in that fence. So it is not a part of a plant, but it still might be some reason that he chose that this place as safe and sound. So that's why. And here a blue tiger butterfly is roosting on a tip of a dead branch, and this sunbeam butterfly is roosting under leaf. So there are various substrate or perch here that a butterfly can use, whether it is plants based on this can be anything. This sunbeam photo has an interesting story about it. This sunbeam, it was roosting continuously this leaf and under leaf for a week straight. So I've observed this behavior on a regular basis. I've seen that this particular individual was roosting 7 days at the same place under this leaf. So what I did was I marked this butterfly, and this picture was taken from this butterfly to see that if it returns to the same butterfly or same individual returns to the same place to do every night. And then after marking, what I've seen that even after marking, it came for 4 days continuously to the same place to roost. So my guess was right that this individual sunbeam was occupying or resting at the same place for 2 weeks straight. So this is a very interesting fact as well. This is called site fidelity in science. So I have never seen the site fidelity in butterflies, but studying the behavior of roosting or butterfly, I've gained that they show site fidelity too. So like this, there are many more interesting behaviors or interesting facts that can be shared with you, and you can see them too if you start observing or start going in the field. So yeah, here is a composition of communal roosting. So now coming to communal roosting, as I've said, that communal roosting is roosting where more than one individual roosts at a particular substrate or a plant. But here, how they roost, they can roost. The composition of the communal roosting can be of two types. One is only single species. In the left picture, you can see there are only blue tigers. This species is known as blue tiger. So only blue tigers are there in this communal roosting. And here, you can say in the right, you can see that there are common crows as well in the middle of this striped tiger communal roosting. So this is also a very interesting fact that why in this picture that they didn't allow any other species to roost, and why here they did. Because this is also communal roosting, this is also communal roosting. So what might be the possible reasons for that? So this is also something to look after, and even if anyone can use, see this. So now I'll be showing two videos where you can see how the butterflies settle in a communal roosting or solitary. So yeah, in this video you saw that the butterflies, they flatter their wings to fight for the spot which they are occupying, and they want to roost there, and each and every individual here is fighting.
Sorry to interrupt, your video was not actually visible. Like, if you could again show the video.
Okay. Is the video visible now?
Yes.
So yeah, this was the video. If you can let me know that everyone saw this video, or I can replay that. So this was the video. So in this video, you can see every individual here is flattering their wings to get their particular spot of roosting, their desired spot where they can roost. So this is a behavior, something which is very unique, and this needs more follow-up research to conclude something that why do they do this and what is the reason for them to do this. This is also a multiple communal roosting, because there are blue tigers as well here, as well as type tigers. So, and now coming to the solitary roosting, here is a video of a common rose roosting solitarily. So you can see this video and you can see the difference as well. Here there is no competition from the other individual or individual butterfly species, so it rests peacefully, and it, as I've already mentioned, that common rose roost with open wing, so they just, it is just showing its final fluttering, and then it will go to roost. So yeah, these are the two types of roosting. And now, what is all the aim of all this study and everything? To conserve the butterflies, because they are a very neglected species. So what we can do as a citizen and as a lover of science, so what we can do to keep this species alive and their population to flourish, that we can do the plantation required for the butterflies, like the shrubs, herbs, trees, and everything. We all know that some of the weeds that people think that is not necessary, and they are waste for the environment, that they are not necessary for the environment. But while doing this study, I've seen that these weeds as a roosting plant for the butterflies. They also serve as host plants and nectaring plants for many of the species. So we have to conserve all the plant species. If we do that, we can protect their habitats as well. So the habitat which is going down, and it is on the brink of destruction, and that's why we have to create this butterfly garden to protect their habitat, protect the habitat of the butterflies, and that's why they are flourishing here. So we need to keep that in mind. And the final incident is, we all know that humans are the worst enemies of any wildlife or any living organisms. So we have to keep avoiding the anthropogenic pressures which comes in the life of the butterflies. In here, in my study, in this park, there is a presence of artificial light. So artificial light is a big problem for the butterflies to roosting, as when they go to roost, so the artificial light will be there. So it always affects the butterflies to roost. Some of the butterflies move from a particular place due to this light, and some have with time started managing these things. So these are all the things, little things we have to keep in mind and keep an eye out to conserve the butterfly species. And finally, the aim of the study was fulfilled, and as I have mentioned that you know that butterflies are very harmless, shy creatures, and even when they are active during the daytimes, you can go close to them. And the reason of roosting, it is still unknown, the why they choose a particular substrate or a particular, there may be few factors which adds, but there are many more factors that can affect this behavior, like the weather condition, their body size. Because while even in the monsoon season, which is now, I've seen that butterflies which are larger, like the nymphalids and the papilionids, they roost much early when it rains because there is no sunlight to work with when it starts raining. So with lysinids as well, they also start roosting around 4:30, 5 o'clock when it rains. So weather is a very integral part of their biological clock, and how their roosting behavior depends on the weather as well. And I've already said their body size and how much energy do they have. Even a big butterfly, if it has consumed all his energy, might roost early. And even a smaller butterfly, like I've mentioned about the owls, the common banded owls and the brown owls, they might roost later. So this can be another reason. And what I've said, that reduction of the anthropogenic pressure, like the artificialized habitat destruction and fragmentation, could help sustaining this population of butterfly. Because as we all know that this butterfly park has more than 100 species recorded because of the habitat they provide. So if we keep all the other things away from the butterflies and keep them how they are, we don't have to do anything. We just have to prevent or reduce all the other disadvantages or destruction of their habitat, what is keeping them from flourishing. So if we are doing that, we can have environmental, the bioindicators. The more butterfly present in a particular place, the more healthy the ecosystem is. So we have to keep everything in mind. And we and now, as I've just started my presentation, that this novel study, why I am so novel, because as I said, roosting is a behavior has been studied in birds and other species, but not in butterflies. So it is very best exposed sources and only, and it wouldn't have been possible if it not for Nature Mates. Because when I joined Nature Mates, there was the global pandemic, and I didn't know what to do. They helped me with all the things to manage my master's, as well as do some research here. And if you are a young researcher or a young student who wants to do research, you can join us, because people here, they give us freedom to explore with our minds, and even they give the freedom to work independently as well. So these are the things you can do if you join Nature Mates, and not only research and not only maintaining the garden and all. Nature Mates also works tirelessly for conserving wildlife throughout our state as well as outside. And this the cyclone Riyas, Amphan, the affected people, Nature Mates also provide relief for them. So they do not only conservation and rescuing, they also do much more social work, which helps you to communicate with the society and the environment, and which further will help you to aware more people as well, which is also an integral part of research. And that's why I do acknowledge the club. Without them, this study or this, I've not been speaking today. And especially I want to sincerely thank Mr. Arjun Basurai, Ms. Sarika Boiddo, Mr. Sopano Roy, Ms. Namrata Das. They were the pillars of my study. Without them, I wouldn't have been here. And Mr. Orkopal, Orchun Pal, Ms. Orpita Roy, Mr. Vitam De, Ms. Pia Mondol, Ms. Raju Das, Mr. Raju Das, and Mr. Amit Mondol for their immense support and help. I'm mentioning all their names because they are an integral part of our EcoPark lab, and without them, I couldn't have been able to identify one plant or even identify. Everyone helped me with this. And finally, this dream of making a perfect habitat like this ecotourism park and this butterfly garden wouldn't have been possible without West Bengal HEDCO and Mr. Devakis sir. So we are all grateful to him. Yeah. You can join us at the given links. You can follow us. And thank you for listening to my talk today. And I want to finish here. Thank you.
Thank you, Prayesh, for the lovely talk. Time for the Q&A session.
Okay, so I'm taking up the questions. We have one question. Abhijit Bura asked that how to attract butterflies in backyard garden of suburb house.
So Abhijit, that's a good question. You don't have to do much to attract flies. Butterflies find a way to come to you. So you just have to learn about the plants or either the plants which they feed on or they lay eggs on. These are very common plants which you can find, like citrus lemon, like the lemon plant, which almost all of us have in our home as well. So you don't have to do anything special. And the curry plants. So all these plants, they are there in our garden. We haven't looked. So if you can manage them, and then you don't have to manage the butterflies, they will come to your garden and they will come to your backyard and you can see them.
Thank you, Prayesh. You can directly ask the question. You can unmute yourself and ask the question. We also have so do you have any question? So yeah, you can ask, unmute yourself and ask question. Yeah,
yes, Abhijit here. Can I ask a question?
Yeah sure.
Webinar, thank you for that. I wanted to ask that how what is the major role of the butterflies in the regional biodiversity or the any habitat? What happens if they all disappear from that region? What are the consequences?
Yeah, like I've repeatedly said that they are the indicators of a healthy ecosystem. So if the butterflies are not there, you won't be having all the things like the plants and the birds as well, because birds they feed on these butterflies. So if the butterflies won't be there, so you won't be having any other wildlife as well. So and if there is no wildlife, you won't have the trees or the other plants which the butterfly or the birds or the other species helps to grow. So if the trees or the plants are not there, so you know what happens after next after that.
Okay, yeah, yeah. But how butterflies play different role than the honeybees, like in the pollinators group?
No, both are pollinators. They don't play some different role. Both are pollinators. Bees are the major pollinators, and butterflies also pollinate with the bees as well.
Okay, okay. So I'm interested in the offline volunteer or internship or any programs, projects offline. Actually, I'm from Maharashtra. So are there any upcoming projects? Or
yes, Abhijit. So what you can do is you can mail us, okay, with your CV. You can write down your our mail ID, that's events.nmnc@gmail.com. I'm writing it in the chat section.
Okay, okay. Sure, sure. Thank you.
I've written it in the chat section. You can just mail us with your CV and we will get back to you as soon as possible. Whenever the position of an internship is open, we'll get back to you, okay? So yeah, we have another question. Not a question, but a very interesting observation. Akshat said that 2 days back, I have seen a butterfly, a female common mormon, roosting on an electric wire. Although garden plants were there, it chooses electric wire as its roosting substratum. What is your opinion about this behavior of the butterfly?
So yeah, I said that even I've shown a picture of a commander roosting on a golf fence, that they can roost anywhere if they find that place safe and the outside of the predator's eyesight. And in your case, the electric wire is an option, might be an option because their electric wires have electricity in them. So maybe other species, other bird species, or mostly birds are there in electric wires and electric poles. So thinking that the birds won't attack them there or they won't sit there next to them, that might be a plausible reason for them to take the electric wire as a substrate. So yeah, it is a very interesting behavior that you mentioned. So keep observing behaviors like this, and yeah, thanks.
So yeah, we have Mr. Arjun Basuroy, our mentor and guide with us. Arjanda, would you like to share something about this very interesting observation?
Hello. So Prayash, it's a nice presentation. This type of work, what we are doing, the small researches on various behavioral activities of butterflies, these in the long run may play a very important role in, you know, conserving butterflies as a whole. Because if you really want to conserve a species, it's very important to know various aspects of its life stages, its lifestyle and life requirements. So if you go by the roosting, what Prayash has just presented, roosting is an activity that a butterfly do for almost 2/3 of the day, and 1/3 of the day they spent for other activities like, you know, nectaring, foraging, infighting, and other things. So when an activity is happening for almost, not almost, happening for the majority part of the day, that activity has a significant role in the well-being of that species for sure. So, you know, whenever we are discussing about a butterfly garden or a butterfly habitat, we always prefer to discuss on plants, which are either the nectar plants or the host plants, but we hardly say anything about the roosting areas or plant which are preferred for roost. So, like this kind of research, what we try to understand is the overall aspect of a butterfly life its requirements and its preferences. So I will like to thank all the participants who have been there for the entire talk and appreciated the talk and encouraged Prayash and other workers like him to carry through all this type of work. And thanks to my team, my butterfly garden team at Eco Park and other places. Thank you.
Thank you, Arjunda. So that's all for this Q&A session. So do anyone have any other question? You can directly ask Prayash. Okay, I think that there is no question left. If you have any question later on, you can ask us. You can simply mail us in events.nmnc@gmail.com. We'll try our best to answer those questions. Thank you. Thank you, Prayash, for this lovely talk. And thank you. Thank you, audience, for joining us today. Hello. Anushka, do you have any question?
Hello, Abhijit here.
Yeah, Abhijit.
I just gone through the Nature Mates Club website.
Yeah.
There I can see it is associated with the Worldwide Fund, WWF.
It was established. Hello. At a part of WWF. Yeah, Arjunda, please enlighten on this.
So we created Nature Mates during our school days as a nature club of WWF. So it's in 1992-93, during that period we created this as a nature club of WWF under WWF India Eastern Regional Office. And eventually in 2006, we registered an NGO, independent NGO, but we keep the Nature Club with us, Nature Mates Nature Club as the name, because we respect the the root of ours. And yes, we are associated with WWF from the beginning and we are still connected for some projects and other things.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, we also have our Facebook page, Nature Mates Nature Club. Please do visit our Facebook page. You will get a lot of information about butterflies, various videos, various photos.
And we also have
YouTube channel.
Sure. Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, and if anyone of you are interested in doing internship with us, so we have opportunity of internship, you can simply mail us in events.nmnc@gmail.com. You can send your CV and we'll look through your CV and we'll get back to you whenever the opportunity is open.
Sure. Thank you. Sure.
Okay, thank you everyone. And finally, I'd like to thank WB Hitco and Mr. Devashish Sen for giving us this opportunity to work in this beautiful habitat, in this beautiful landscape, Ecotourism Park Butterfly Garden. And Arjunda, you can conclude the session.
Thanks to everybody. And, we are an NGO who are into wildlife research. And we also support informal research. Means it's not necessary that you need to be a MSc student, you need to be a zoology student or a botany student. Research is not a monopoly of educated people. There are plenty of examples across the globe where brilliant research being done by ordinary common man who have common senses and who have a liking for doing the same. So Nature Mates is a platform where anyone who is truly interested, who is truly passionate, who really want to be a part of, part of nature study, doing research in nature and other things are welcome. You can come down to our office. We do have a brilliant library where you can you can search books. We have a very good collection of books, more than 4,000 books we have on various subjects, not only butterflies, but birds, trees, plants, many magazines, many, you know, journals we have. So all of you who are a participant here and to all of your friends who are interested, genuinely interested, passionate, and like to contribute in the field of nature study, in the field of wildlife research, are most welcome. Thanks again for participating. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. One more thing, that we are going to celebrate Big Butterfly Month in the coming September, and we are planning to have lots of webinar. So you will get notification about this webinar in our official Facebook page as well as in our website. So till then, I think we will meet very soon with a new session of webinar. And till then, please stay safe, because this is a pandemic year. Everyone, please stay safe and healthy. Okay. So goodbye, all.
Thank you, sir.